Eminence Front. Has a newsy type of feel with a rock out type of feel. I was dancing listening to the music as we were introducing it. And I'm just like, I love this fucking shit.
I felt betrayed by not using the Offspring this time around, but I'll be honest, it's a good song and might permanently replace the current song we use. So
you got to kick it up a little bit.
Change it up. We've always been about changing things up here every once in a while. So, you know, I've already gone through enough co-hosts, God knows.
Oh, so. God. what number am I? That's a $4,000 question right there, right?
Not including when we had multiples, five?
Five? So I'm the sixth co-host that you went through.
Yeah, but you're like the well, when we started, we had three. So and then three other people they went away, and then I had a rotating group for a while, and then you're the first one who's been somewhat permanent. So
oh dear God, I have poor hope for the continuance of these journeys that we take, Matt.
Oh, by the way, this is a live call-in show, so if you want to call us, boot up Skype. Give me a message at Admiral Joker, and I'll bring you into the call. So
yeah,
this is a live. Or hit us up if you can't get a hold of me. Hit us up in the chat. We'll post up there where to call into, and you can join in the conversation. This is a call-in show. Always has been, and probably always will be. So George, this was a topic that you wanted to do for a very long time. You brought this up to me months ago. This week, what are we talking about this week?
Well, we're talking about the right to repair. And, you know, this is something that has been passionate with me for quite a while. I sit there and look at all the wasted electronics that are out there that people don't think they can necessarily repair. But sure enough, we are able to actually repair it. It's not that hard to use a soldering iron. To do a little solder. It's not that hard to replace a transistor. I grew up in a household where my family had these soldering irons, and I watched my dad solder transistors, solder wires together and all that stuff. And I'm not all that perfect at it. I will readily admit that. But at the end of the day, I think we're starting to get back to that point. And There's an interesting origin story behind that, right? And maybe you could talk a little further into that. But it even goes beyond what you're thinking and what you've kind of outlined as we were talking about this earlier. So but why don't you start on that?
This isn't anything new necessarily, and this is for electronics. Motor Vehicles Right to Repair Act has been around for a couple of years now in several states. The right to repair pretty much says that you have that it makes manufacturers make documentation available so others can do repairs to devices and make genuine parts available through a retail channel. This is to prevent companies like Apple, Samsung, or worse, car manufacturers, BMW, Mercedes, etc., from having a market or from saying only you can go to only authorized repair centers. You have to go pay sometimes exorbitant prices to get your devices fixed. Or worse, they go and say, this isn't supported anymore. We don't have spare parts. Or even if they are available, they're not going to replace it because it's end of life. So the planned obsolescence kicked in. We're not going to repair it. You have to go. We'll give you maybe a credit, but you have to go buy a new phone. This is really big with Apple and Samsung because they liked it. Because let's face it, every phone you have is part of a cycle of planned obsolescence. Planned obsolescence says that within this time frame, this phone will be obsolete, and users will be encouraged in some fashion to go to the next phone. Most devices, it's a year or two. Now, you and I are big geeks, and I can tell you right now, planned obsolescence doesn't work like it used to.
It doesn't.
Because especially in the PC market, it used to be, well, video games were what kept planned obsolescence going. Because let's face it, you had to upgrade your PC to something newer, something faster, something better in order to play the latest games. Nowadays, you can get a PC that's still several years old and play most modern games. Now, that's mostly because I will give credit to the console generation. Consoles themselves are based on older PC architecture at this point. Mm-hmm. And unable to keep it going, they will... in order to keep things going, they will make it backwards compatible to the to a console generation, which usually computers are ahead of that game.
Right.
So because of that, they'll make a game. They don't make really games specifically for computers anymore. Most of them are made directly for consoles. And because of that, planned obsolescence doesn't work like you used in the PC market. I mean, if you want to play Quake or something like that, Crisis, you had to get a latest PC. And phones are kind of, we're going in that direction as well. I mean, you're an Apple guy.
For the most part.
And iPhones had built-in planned obsolescence for many years. Mm-hmm. You always were encouraged to go to the latest and greatest Apple iPhone at all times. Samsung, they're not as bad, but they still do it. Android doesn't have that much planned obsolescence because it's an open source. It's a more readily available. They have to support older hardware.
Yeah.
Because it's part of the platform. So it's not as bad at times, but it still is.
Well, here's the challenge in that whole, narrative there. So depending on the, platform, right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is only my personal experience, but this iPhone 7 has lasted for a lot longer than I would have had an Android phone, right? So the Android phones for me lasted not more than a couple of years. This lasted a good 3-4 years, and in fact the only reason why I've actually replaced it, so to say, is because of the crack on the side. Yeah. But I'll tell you this, man. If I turn it on right now, it's booting up.
Yeah.
You see that?
I have several Android phones I can still use. I don't use them. I have an S3 I can still use. I have a lot of phones I can still use. But if you need to get them repaired, good luck.
Exactly.
Used to be you can't go. You have to ship it or mail it. Or you'd have to get a refurb phone and pay tons of money for that. Sometimes as much as half the price of a new one, which isn't like $200-$300. We're talking $400-$600. Or get a used phone that could be blocked because it's stolen or something like that off eBay or something. Now, I will say this. There are several companies out there nowadays, luckily, that are trying to fill in the gap. One of the big one is uBreak iFix. They are an authorized repair center for several manufacturers, including Samsung. They have a Senex Samsung parts. They use their manuals. They have a set standard. They are certified technicians, and they fix them. But the whole thing with the right to repair is saying you have a right to get this repaired and not just send it to the manufacturer OEM. You can take it anywhere to get it fixed. You're not restricted. And best of all, you're not going to – it won't – affect your warranty. That's the big thing, your warranty. A lot of them won't honor it unless you send it to them.
Right. And so it's a very sketchy proposition when you go to these independent retailers versus the going to a certified repair shop. But let's be realistic. Certified repair shops are not real certified repair shops anymore.
No.
You go to Geek Squad at Best Buy or another certified place. They'll do some basic diagnostics at the store or at the facility, and then they'll send it to the manufacturer to
their actual real repair shop. Usually, there's a local. It can be either local or somewhere regional that the company runs, which actually has the real technicians that do the repairs.
That's correct.
They do the Best Buy used to do that. I don't know if they still do. But Best Buy used to do that with Geek Squad.
Best Buy does. Best Buy still does it.
I haven't used them in a very long time.
Yeah.
But I know they do more in shop now than they used to back in the day.
Yeah, it's changed slowly. But when it's all said and done, there have been some... there's still challenges. They're not going to... I mean, they do basic diagnostic work. at these places. They don't go beyond and go to the hardware level. And that's, I think, where the challenges lie. So, like, Best Buy is not going to necessarily replace a broken screen, right? They're going to send it somewhere to do it. Whereas if you go to an independent retailer, they're going to replace the screen, right? If there is a problem with a slot here, there are independent retailers that will just, you know, desolder the slot and put a new slot, put a new USB or put a new connector on it. And so those independent retailers exist. They're all out there. One independent retailer I follow is Lewis Rossman, and he has a YouTube channel which is phenomenal. He goes into MacBook repairs and the right to repair in a great amount of detail. But they're few and far between, and these independent retailers are fighting against a larger corporate entity that just wants people to buy new stuff. Well, guess what? We're in a new environment now. It's COVID-19. People don't have as much money. I mean, granted, I went and I bought an iPhone 11. It was pretty quick to buy it. And I felt like getting a new phone anyway, but I felt like getting a new phone.
Yeah.
It wasn't that I couldn't repair it. And I fully intend on repairing the screen on this iPhone 7. So that way I could
I've had mine repaired quite a few times. These all glass phones, I'd say it, they don't last.
They don't.
Yeah, they're not designed to last forever. They scratch, they nick, you sit in it wrong, you know, drop it, whatever. It's going to break the whole damn screen. And I hate that of modern phones. You know, I miss the good old days of the Nokia phones where I could, you know, hit someone with it and possibly kill them. Mm-hmm. Those were wonderful phones.
Yeah, but here's a challenge, right? Going forward, you know, they claim the advocates say that we already have options as consumers. We already can go to independent repair shops or all that stuff, but that's not the case. No. And the reason why is because to the independent retailers, they're not making the schematics available to others. And
or the parts.
Yeah, the parts, exactly.
Because a lot of times they're getting knockoffs from China or China. They're not as good as the OEM parts. They're like if you go get your phone screen replaced from a not authorized shop, you're not going to get an AMOLED screen or something. You're probably going to get an LCD equivalent or some cheap equivalent that it works, but it's not the same part, especially for screens. Main boards are usually refurbished. You know, they've been refurbished or taken from other phones that have water damage or worse, and they've just had some capacitors and stuff fixed. But, you know, there's no guarantee that's going to work either. Plus, face it, I've had phones fixed. They don't come together. They don't put them back together right. You know, it just doesn't work. But and it used to be back in the day, you could fix your own stuff. I mean, I've had ovens and appliances where if you open them up, they were sealed or there were schematics for how to fix the device.
Exactly right.
Inside of them. I mean, many small appliances had that for years.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, you don't get that. You don't get a service manual unless you pay for it. Or you have someone come out and get it, which, to be honest, there is a big I know it sounds weird. There is a big, big market online for pirated repair manuals.
Mm-hmm.
Big market for that.
Yeah.
For several devices, including electronics. Luckily, there's plenty of sites nowadays like iFix, I think, is one of them.
iFixit.
Yeah, they're iFixit. They're really good.
I got a toolkit from them.
Yeah.
I got a toolkit from them. And that's one of the things we're going to be doing is I'm going to actually be repairing the I have two iPads with broken screens. I have the iPhone 7 with broken screens. And really, like, you think about it, the all this technology that you're talking about, you know, you mentioned a laptop from 7 years ago. Well, I have an iPad Air 2 sitting up here.
Good laptop,
by
the way.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I have an iPad Air 2 as a teleprompter right now. I have it hooked up through Duet and hooked up as my streaming setup. It works perfectly. The only problem is that it has a cracked screen. But I can see it. The video works perfectly fine. And so why am I going to get rid of it if it works perfectly fine and the only thing is cosmetic?
That's, well, I have a lot of old tablets laying around. I meant tablet, by the way, not laptop. I have a lot of old tablets, you know, lying around that, and one of them I am going to eventually use as a teleprompter. You know, old phones are great. Just even if you don't use the phone function, they work great for your kids. If they want a nice cheap gaming device for mobile phone, it works great. Works as a good MP3 or video player. A lot of the phones do.
So remember this. So remember this sucker here.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, netbook from 2009, right?
Well, those nowadays we call them Chromebooks. Chromebooks are, yeah, I love the Chromebook thing. Everyone's like, oh my God, a Chromebook. What is that? I said, it's a netbook. We've had those since the, we've had that since 2007. And nobody really, I remember when they were the big thing. I remember when they used to sell those at like AT&T and Verizon. Like, oh, hey, yeah, you buy a new phone, you get a netbook.
Yep.
And they're really cheap laptops. I got a few.
Yeah. So there is a solution out there called Android X86, right? Mm-hmm. I can't boot it up right now. It's running low batteries, but this actually allows me to use modern Android applications on a netbook that's from 2009, right? So that blows your mind. Right, because you would think that right to repair, repurposing old technology for new is something that you cannot do. Folks, you can repurpose old technology. You can repair all that stuff. And there are many different things, different manuals and different guides out there. But, you know, but the problem is that when you look at the laws and the method that we're living in right now, you have a lot of advocates that are lobbying against these rights. Yeah,
I mean, and not just like small companies. You have industry organizations such as CompTIA is fighting this.
Oh,
Apple,
yeah.
The ESA, mm-hmm. ESA, the game companies. John Deere, I know they're in electronics, but still, they fight it. AT&T, John Deere. Okay, look, I live in a
John
farm.
Deere.
I live in a farm. I live in a cattle ranch.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you right now, John Deere are dang Nazis when it comes to repairs.
So
if
you have
a John Deere John Deere tractor, good luck trying to find spare parts for that thing to do it yourself. You have to take it to a repair shop because they will not sell the part to you unless you're an authorized repair person. And to get someone to replace a John Deere is stupid money. And that's unlike an ATV, like a Gator, which is essentially a glorified golf cart. It's insane. Even AT&T and Verizon are fighting these efforts. They don't want you fixing your own devices. Why?
They don't.
Because there's money in it to get certain people to do it by having people certifications, which, hey, we work IT, trust me. Certifications are a big money maker for them, you know, especially Cisco and Microsoft. They want you to get these certifications and only you to be able to start troubleshoot these things so it can justify the insane money that they ask for these things. Places like Samsung only sell their parts to authorized repair centers, who also have to pay a fee for being an authorized repair center, having their people trained and meeting those standards, which you can say, well, that's a good thing. But it also doesn't let you fix your own device. I mean, face it, there's plenty of you. We're retro gamers. Both of us are.
Yep.
And there's plenty of things on the market right now where I can go out there right now and modify many of my old consoles to support things they never supported before, add new features. I can modify an NES to output HDMI and or RGB, which it didn't do natively. I can modify an N64 and get better sound into my Sega Genesis. You can modify your ColecoVision to do composite out, which I don't think the Coleco does composite. I think it was only RF, right?
Yeah, it was only RF.
Yeah, same thing.
I have one. I still hooked up to RF.
And the Atari 2600 also only put RF, but they have composite mods for that too. I mean, mods aren't the same thing as repair, but they're also as important to us because of that.
But I think what you're missing is that they're lumping it together as a topic. So it's right to repair. but also right to modify and do what you want to do with the technology. When you buy a piece of technology, it's your technology, okay? And there's a bigger philosophical question on what you need to, what you can and cannot do with this technology as you buy it, all right? If I am to jailbreak an iPhone, for example, right? The challenge is that if I jailbreak that iPhone, it could potentially be bricked. And from that standpoint, that's a specific issue. So,
if you break it, then forget it.
You're done.
Buy a new one.
Yeah, you're done.
And even if it's under warranty, they won't help you.
And I don't know
how many times I have legitimately tried to upgrade a firmware on a phone, camera, anything, and had the thing brick on me during an update.
Yeah, and you know that's going back to your point about John Deere. There are hacks around the computerized systems that monitor these tractors, and there's numerous documentaries that outline that with the farmers, and that's the only way they're able to get around having a representative come out to plug something into their computer to get a code, then go back to a dealer to get a part to come back and then repair it. And when you look at farmers from that standpoint, they're losing productivity when they're doing this stuff, right? That's the challenge with this right to repair, because back even as far back as the 80s, when you look at a John Deere tractor, it was a modular piece. You were able to, if something in a tractor went, you could easily just take the part out, put a new part in, and you're good to go. And in fact, to that point, John Deere is somewhat suffering from that, because a lot of the farmers are going on auction, going online, and buying the older tractors.
I'm a Massey Ferguson guy, so that's just me.
Yeah, well, my point is that they're going back, they're going online, and they're buying the older tractors from like 30, 40, even 50 years ago. You know why? Because they can be repaired.
Yep.
If you're broken down in a field.
And tractors last forever. Most diesel engines can last a very long time.
Absolutely.
There are people who have tractors from the 30s, and I think the tractor we use mainly here is from the 60s, and it still runs.
Yeah.
It rusted and not in the best of shape, but it still works.
But metal can be repaired, Matt. That's the whole thing.
And the best thing is, we don't have to have the federal government step in to fix this. In fact, it takes one state. Because face it, once one state does it and passes the law, at that point, the parts are in the wild. You open up a shell company in that state, you get the parts you need or order from, saying you're from that state, and pretty much if one state's going to allow it, it's going to be allowed nationwide in the retail channel.
Yeah.
Maybe even worldwide.
Yeah. So there's a lot
out there then.
Yeah, so there are groups that are going from state to state that are testifying and submitting these bills for right to repair. Lewis Rossman of the Lewis Rossman Repair Group, somebody I follow on YouTube, as I mentioned, has been going from state to state and was in Maryland as recently as February or March doing a testimony there. This is going to be comical when I say it, and for some people who are listening to this or seeing this might actually appreciate that. But when these advocates actually get questioned or these lobbyists get questioned on why it's so hard to replace the rubber pads on an Xbox One controller, right? And you have to get a special screw for all that stuff, right? They bring up the concept of robust conversations. Like, well, we should have a more robust conversation regarding this, right?
Right.
Yeah. Well, we're having a robust conversation here on this show, okay? This is a robust conversation. I'm not going to sit there and have a robust conversation behind fucking closed doors and slip a few dollars on the table saying, oh, you know what? Just let this slide. Let this go a little bit, okay? Fuck that shit. The problem is that these people, the problem is that, you know, there are people that want to repair, and now more than ever, people are going to want to save money, right? So am I going to pay $500 to the Apple store to get my iPhone 7 screen repaired versus, you know, going to a repair shop and paying, I don't know, like $100 for that? Guess what I'm going to pay, Matt? I'm going to pay the $100. That's a challenge. But even with that, right, it's not hard to repair this screen. Yeah. In fact, you go on iFixit and you got the tools, you can order the glass, the video screens, yeah. and there are step-by-step directions. And yeah. If you look, it's simply what you do is you take the tool, you pry it off the special plastic or special sticky film there. You carefully put a new sticky film on it, and then you carefully put the glass. Maybe a little precise. You know, if your hands might shake, that might be a little different, but it's not hard to do. And that's what that's what they're perpetuating. They're saying, oh, the ordinary consumer can't repair the tractor, or the ordinary farmer can't repair the tractor. The ordinary consumer can't fix your phone. The ordinary consumer can't modify something to their liking. And that's not true. There's a lot of instructional videos that make it easy.
Soldering is not the easiest thing in the world. I mean, look, I have some soldering equipment. Mm-hmm. Can I solder? Sure. Rich 859 brought up something interesting we'll bring up here in a second. He was talking about software that can help fix your computer that's kind of like that as well, but do be aware that a lot of those things don't really help with anything. If your computer is running slow, there's usually an underlying problem. People are like, well, I do a fresh install of Windows, my computer is now running faster. Well, mm-hmm. Yeah, because you have less programs installed and less things running in the background. Usually, if your computer's running slow, you really want to do some investigation and figure out what applications you're running, because most people are just going to reinstall all those applications again anyways and end up right back where you're at. And that's another topic for another time, is bloatware. I hate mm-hmm. bloatware. I hate that everything I put on my computer needs to install some stupid application to run, and all it does is just add overhead on my computer and make it run slower. I can't even install a damn mouse or keyboard anymore without installing software that takes forever to frickin' load. And nowadays, they just expect you to have an SSD drive, so it doesn't really matter. Look, I may have an SSD drive, but I don't want to spend 20 minutes waiting. I just still don't want this extra bloatware if I have a spinning desk. Because face it, not everybody has an SSD in their computer at this point.
No, nobody, not many people. I mean, I got an SSD on this MacBook, and that's it. The rest are, they're spinning discs. But yeah, to Rich 859's point, it's obviously a scam. If you follow a Twitch user, Kid Boga, on YouTube and as well as Twitch here, he live streams how he gets these scammers in, and they take you for a ride. So they'll start by talking about how we detected these problems with the computer, run some bogus code on a batch file, and at the end they'll quickly pay, saying your computer's infected, right?
You know what? We should do a show on scammers. On common scams, because some of those are getting really sophisticated these days.
Oh, they are.
Not to get off topic too much, but I got one recently where they call me on debts I've paid in the past. They somehow can find out of old debts that I have through a soft credit check, and all of a sudden they're calling me about a bank loan that I paid off decade ago, saying I still owe money on it. Mm-hmm. And that would work against people who weren't in the know. Anything like that. So, yeah, be aware of scams. We'll do a show on that. Not next time, but maybe the time after that. Because scams can get interesting. Trust me, there's a lot more than just the Nigerian prince out there.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, but I'm more worried about the Tiger King coming to take my money. But back on point, you're right. We are running into an issue now where the companies are trying to close the channel. And mm-hmm. they want to be able to control who gets access to the parts. And it isn't that hard to do repairs. There's a lot of how-to guides out there. Now, I'm not the best with a soldering iron, I'll admit it. Fine soldering, like on a phone, not the easiest thing in the world, especially if you, I don't have the steadiest of hands. But you should have the option available to do so. I am of the mind that more things need to be modular. I know for years and years and years, the EU and Europe has been pushing to standardize phone plugs. I mean, every phone look, for the most part, it's all USB except for Apple, because fuck you. everybody uses USB-C, micro USB, mini USB isn't really as used anymore, but they all use USB for the most part. Now, you and I are old enough to remember, God damn, how many different freaking cell phones charging plugs were there for every manufacturer had their own standard.
Oh, yeah.
They all had different plugs, even within the same same company, has a different plug for every single phone.
Yep.
And trying to find a charger for your phone was damn near impossible. If you broke, unless you paid a stupid amount of money or got some knockoff that probably will toast your phone because it has a bad regulator. It has a bad transformer or something in it, and it's been getting really, really bad. And but the EU, I know Europe for years has been trying to push on this to get this standardized, and I know they have touched it here in the U.S. for a while. That's why Apple's kind of uses Thunderbolt, and even though Thunderbolt is an Apple thing, it is a non-Apple.
Well, let me stop you there. Actually, most Apple, I mean, there's the Thunderbolt for iPhones, but most of Apple MacBook Pros and iMacs and all that stuff, they are on USB-C now. So Thunderbolt has gone out of the way. But to your point about modularity, I mean, look, modularity is already there. This is something, you know, there's advocates that say that they are we're always in search for a problem to solve, right? Well, in this case, there's not really much of a problem to solve. The industry is going towards the USB-C standards, and for the most part, has gone towards USB.
Even Thunderbolt does use the USB-C form factor.
Exactly. Yeah. And so the point, and so to that point, standardization. I mean, look, you can't standardize everything, okay? Because then it removes the competitiveness. Therein lies a challenge. There are many manufacturers out there that could create adapters and other components that will. That will allow you to use, say, a Thunderbolt on a USB-C and all that stuff. So, I think the EU is searching for a problem that doesn't exist. Now, going back,
well, it used to be a huge problem, not so much anymore. Of this looming threat of them standardizing it, a lot of these companies have gone in line, and I understand why they want proprietary. Face it, these are not open standards. USB is. You have to pay money to a consortium when you use USB. You have to pay money when you use Thunderbolt. Thunderbolt is not Apple. It is actually owned by Intel and Apple.
Yes.
HDMI is a very common one, but every HDMI device you have to pay a royalty fee for. I think it's like 10 cents per device or something, but it's like per like a couple thousand, so you got to pay a bunch of money up front, which is why a lot of companies go with DisplayPort. Guess what? DisplayPort doesn't have a license fee.
Yeah.
There actually, it is not a, I believe DisplayPort is a free to use standard. A lot of these were free to use standards that have fallen away because look, industry has pushed to use the proprietary or the more popular standards such as HDMI, USB, and those. It's not like in the day of serial ports where that was an open standard, you know? So, same problem with the right to repair. As more and more companies, with this looming, they have been opening that door a little bit more. They don't want it to be regulated. They don't want people to say, you know, we're going to push a law where anybody can do this. which mm-hmm. is why if I go get my phone fixed, it's going to cost me a few hundred dollars to get my screen fixed. But mm-hmm. you know what? It's not going to cost me $800 to buy a phone out of contract.
This
or $1,000 for a phone out
yeah.
of contract. Where
yeah.
it used to be, that's what it would cost you is $500, $600, $700.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is, Rich brought up a good point. Batteries. Batteries are the one thing I hate the most in any phone. Face it.
Yeah.
Most devices, not just phones, laptops. My work laptop I have here sitting next to me has a built-in battery. I cannot replace it if it goes bad.
Oh, but you can.
Oh, I can, but it's not as easy as... It's a work laptop, so it's not like I just order one and pop it off and put a new one on like I used to with my Lenovo. No, I gotta go and open up the bottom of the case, get to the battery, and then take it out, put a new one in.
Mm-hmm.
Not as much. Good luck trying to take out a phone battery. You gotta break the seal in the phone, take the whole thing, take the back off, and then reseal it back together again. That's not an easy process. Where an older phone's are just a case, you pop the back off, you put the battery in, put the back on some clips, and there you go. You're off to the races.
Yeah. So Rich said that his battery is croaking, as you mentioned, but he is a fan. So thank you. We got a fan.
Yay!
Awesome. Yeah. So that's good stuff. But you know what, Matt? The problem you make it sound more difficult than what it is. You break the seal, but
I'm speaking in the term of the average user. You know,
the average user can do it, but then the average user can do it. That's the thing. I mean, it's not hard to do. I mean, look, we have a little more technical knowledge than most others.
Yeah.
I mean, I can solder, although I will admit
I've taken many of phones apart to replace batteries using a spudger tool and a few other things. It's really not that hard.
It used to be you
use your fingernail and pop the back off. I miss those days.
This is true. Yes. I mean, the thing is that what they wanted to try to do with this is that they wanted to build more water-resistant phone, water-resistant devices. But at the same time...
Really? Because I remember the original iPhone doing this, and that damn thing, if you leave it out in the rain, it stops working, and it was like that.
Yeah, well, the newer, yeah, so I experiment. So my S5, so interesting story, my S5 Active that I had for a while, I was told that it is water-resistant, right? And so just for the sake of argument, I did go in the pool with it.
Only
and,
the dry kind of water.
Yeah, exactly right. The dry kind of water. And so I went in the pool with it and even recorded. I just for the sake of, just for experimentation, I dipped it in the water, right? And next thing I know, it conked out. I called Samsung. And they said, oh, well, if it's water damage, then you're not going to be able to repair it. I said, well, wait a second. You said this was water resistant. Well, watertight versus water resistant are two different things. What? Really? That's the stupidest thing I've ever heard.
Well, that's saying it's impact resistant, and I drop it and it shatters the screen. Oh, yeah, that's not impact resistant.
Yeah, well, why do they have protectants on? And you know, it's funny. This iPhone 7, that still works, right? The reason why it lasts so long is because I had a battery pack protector on it, and so it only started to show its age when I was jogging one day. I had my headphones in place and I had it in my pocket. I ran, mm-hmm. I was running downhill. All of a sudden, it just went flying out of my pocket and hit one side, and there was a little crack here that started. And even beyond that, I was using it for a couple weeks after that. And then the crack just got bigger. And that's when I decided to get the 10. And, you know, it's not so much that I couldn't repair it, as I meant, or I'm sorry, the 11 Pro I got. And it's not so much that I couldn't repair it, which I'm planning on repairing it anyway, because I can repurpose this technology for other things. Yeah. And that's what people don't understand. Just because there is a crack in the screen doesn't necessarily mean you throw it away.
No.
And there are
just
many things you can do it.
Because the system doesn't run as fast as it used to or as powerful. Look, repurpose. You and I have both repurposed these things, repurposed servers and things many a times. My server back here is Zen, which is a open source hypervisor. It runs my file server, which runs on CentOS. It runs pfSense, which is my VPN. And that is my old repurposed workstation. Before that, it was an old Intel Core 2 Duo that I got from an old beaten down desktop that someone threw out because they're like, I don't want it anymore. I took the parts out, put it into a working desktop case because I did. And guess what? I had a brand new server that works great. Hey, you have an old computer? Take it, repurpose it, give it a new life. It can be a media server. It can be a retro gaming box for playing things like old games or even an emulator system.
And funny you mention that, because I had a Dell Inspiron B120 that I used when I was I bought it for completing my master's coursework, and after that I upgraded to this computer over here, which was a Core i5 Windows 7 based machine with a big 17 inch screen, and then I went to my MacBook. The reason why I went to my MacBook is I hated Windows 10, right? So I decided, you know what, let me go Mac.
I love Windows 10.
I'm not much of a fan, but let me tell you something.
Then again,
right?
I like Windows 8, so I'm a bit of a masochist.
You know, you are a masochist if you like Windows 8. I don't know anybody who likes Windows 8.
Windows 8. I like Metro.
You're the only one that liked Windows 8. I hated Windows 8, and that's just I had Windows 8.
People hated Explorer, which is the Windows GUI that were with the start button and stuff when Windows 95 came out. If the internet existed back then, people had been bitching too then.
Yeah, I don't mind.
1995, the internet wasn't really a thing.
Yeah, I didn't mind the start button. That I was fine with. But
I remember people hating. People who use Windows 3.1 don't realize Program Manager was actually built into Windows up until what? XP was still a part of the OS. I think it was still in 98, and you can edit your WinINI file and tell it to start Program Manager instead of Explorer, and you'd end up with Program Manager.
You still can edit your Windows INI. And, you know, that's the thing.
Yeah, but I don't think Program Manager is still a part of Windows.
Believe, I think it might be. I don't remember. I thought I saw a YouTube video back then. But, you know, you raise a good point. And going back to what I was originally saying.
Don't know whose hairline Blair is referring to, but thank you.
Okay. Nice hairline. I would say probably yours, because I don't have a hairline. My hair is very short. Sing Gangnam Style.
I don't sing.
I don't.
Well,
sing
I do,
either.
But I sing solo. Solo, no one can hear me. Ha! Yeah. Actually, I'm a pretty good singer, but I don't like singing.
Yeah, I'm not. You know, Gangnam Style is not something that I.
Only when I get drunk and go sing karaoke.
Go sing karaoke. You sing karaoke, huh? That's an interesting piece there. But now going back
I can kill some Elton John. I probably shouldn't say that.
Please don't. Going back to what I was saying, right? The B120.
William Shatner. I am a rocket man.
Oh, God. I am a rocket man.
Out in here on fumes alone. Yes.
Going back to what I was saying. For the 50th time, my Inspiron B120, right? I installed 32-bit Ubuntu Linux. I installed RetroPie on it, and I have a console that is hooked up via a VGA adapter to my HDMI on my 65-inch screen TV, and I'm able to play all my favorite retro games from the Atari 2600 all the way up to some of the Neo next generation stuff. And it's beautiful because
if you take a phone like this and jailbreak it like an older phone, you can take that install emulators on it, and all of a sudden you have a retro gaming machine that can play everything from a or everything from the dawn of gaming up until even a PlayStation 1, and some can even play PlayStation 2 and GameCube games quite well on a cell phone.
Yeah, and even with this netbook, right? I got Android x86 installed on this, and I'm able to stream Pluto freaking TV. I'm able to get Netflix. Yep. I'm able to get Hulu. A little modification needed. Still a little laggy at times. But you can easily work it out.
That is the fear right now of the manufacturers. Look, planned obsolescence doesn't work anymore at the end of the day. You can take any old, pretty much I would say since past 5 years, probably, maybe more, since the Core i line came out. CPUs and technology, now GPUs have had leaps and bounds, of course, but CPUs and things like that haven't had that much innovation. They've increased number of cores. CPU speed hasn't gone up that much. Memory requirements haven't increased like they used to. The operating system itself is, hey, face it, Windows 10 is pretty damn lean compared to most, is a fairly lean operating system. Even Microsoft isn't releasing new OSs like they used to. I mean, face it, Windows 10 has been around for a while. And Windows 10 really is just Windows 8 improved upon. It's not actually a new operating system. Windows 8 came out in what? 2012? So we're running on the same OS core for almost what? 13 years?
Yeah.
2012. So, yeah.
It's insane.
A jerk in the chat.
Yeah, no, I'm just watching that and it's being funny. So, but to your point, I'm just gonna give my opinion to these guys. But you know what? It goes back to the point. We have the technology out there, and we can repurpose it. Truth of the matter is that when you look at the operating systems like Windows 7, the Windows 10s of the world, and all that stuff, it's all about overhead for giving certain experiences. But there's so many code sets that you can install on these older pieces of technology that go back to the point about right to repair, and I would say almost right to repurpose that we have, and you know. Let's be realistic. We have a lot of e-waste out there, right? There's a lot of we're a throwaway culture that we see some old technology and we throw it away. But there are a lot of things that you can do.
People gotta have the new shiny.
Yeah, exactly.
There are people who literally face it. They're Apple. Hey, I hate to pick on Apple, but it's the truth. A lot of people live on the newest thing from Apple. Whenever they release something new, they're always the first ones in line. You and I have both seen Apple stores on launch days. It's insane. And I know of very few, other than maybe game consoles, and I've seen some insane things for game consoles. I lived during the N64. I remember the N64 and the Wii and the how crazy those were. People go crazy over the new shiny. And yeah, they just throw out the new one when it comes out. You know, toss it away.
Yeah.
Don't think of it. And they just go into a landfill. They're not recycled. You can recycle these, by the way. They are recyclable. But no one ever takes them to get recycled.
Right.
By the way, do recycle your electronics, please. These are very toxic devices. The batteries and stuff are not. The batteries in here are toxic. They are bad for the environment. And I'm not an environmentalist. Please recycle your electronics.
Yeah, but you just reuse them, Matt. That's the problem.
If you got something that's completely broken that doesn't work, repair it.
That's the problem. People don't repair these devices. There are many people out there, independent retailers, that can fix a little transistor or replace a little slot. 9 out of 10 times, if somebody throws out a device, it's probably due to a smaller problem versus like a connector versus a larger problem like a burned out processor.
Yeah.
And look, even if you cannot get that repaired, right? You could easily take it apart, use it for parts to repair other devices.
Yeah, and
that's what we need to do.
Yeah, yeah, things need to be more modular. You need to be able to move parts between things too.
Yeah.
I miss those days, especially with things like PCs. If a PC breaks, I can take a part from an old PC, put it into a new one. They're fairly modular, fairly easy to repair. Mm-hmm. You can fix them. No soldering, no real labor involved. Phones, usually you have to have soldering. Some soldering skills, but look, seriously, go on YouTube. There's a lot of, you may spend a couple $100 on a decent soldering setup. I did. I got an actual desoldering station and a soldering station because, face it, I suck with a desoldering wick. You wouldn't believe. Every time I try to use a desoldering wick, I end up actually just soldering the wick to the solder. And I don't want to get there. I suck at desoldering with a wick. But you know what? Desoldering station, done.
Yeah.
It's that simple. And you just get a magnifying glass, a steady hand, and you can fix these things all day long. You can find and not only that, a lot of parts on here are somewhat modular. Your screen, not soldered, ribbon cable. All you do is you take the screen out, snap in the new ribbon cable, put some screws back in, bam, back together again, as good as new. You can do that with any device. Laptops, guess what? You can find screens all day long online to replace screens. They're not that hard to replace.
Mm-hmm.
They're really not. If your laptop's running slow, go buy an SSD. Seriously, the slowest part of any laptop is always the disk drive. Most cheap-ass laptops come with a 5400 RPM spinning disk drive. Those are, God forbid, a 4800 RPM drive. You want to talk about slow? I mean, these things are so slow that it literally takes several 5-10 minutes to load Windows. You take a 200, maybe you can get an SSD on like Newegg nowadays for close to what, $80.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
you put that $80 SSD in, which most of those you don't really have to take apart the laptop. You pop the bottom off of it, and there's usually a little door. It slides out. You put it in. You put that SSD in. Guess what? All of a sudden, your laptop performs just like for load times, anyways, like any modern laptop.
Mm-hmm.
Add more memory to your laptop. I'm running an old ThinkPad as my personal laptop. I've been using it for the past almost 10 years now. Why haven't I replaced it? I don't need to. I just add a new. I haven't replaced the processor. It does have 16 gigs of memory, but I haven't replaced the processor. I'm fixing to put an SSD in it, and trust me, that will breathe all new life into that old system.
So I gotta. I'm just looking at the chat, and I'm seeing the. I'm seeing some fun people comment there, which I'm gonna comment in a second, but. But you're right. At the and I did the same thing. Like my wife's laptop, I upped the RAM. I replaced a solid state drive. Oh, I did get rid of Windows 8, and got rid of Windows 10. I actually went KDE, and it runs a lot better. So yeah, that's just an FYI there. Some interesting comments there about.
We're not doing a North Korea Trump show right now.
Well, here's the thing, right? I'll just give my very, very quick opinion on it.
No, we're running short on time. I don't want to get into
short
that.
Time. All right.
Your short opinions usually turn into the monologues that make the characters on Babylon 5 seem like they're given a simple one-line speech. We can get into that kind of stuff later. You know, you want to talk about Trump and shit? Go watch Fox News or MSNBC. We do that on occasion on this show, but I try to avoid it for the most part because I usually like to have a little more balanced people, so I like to get liberals on when I do that.
Mm-hmm.
But
Do we really want to go down that road? I'm only kidding. I'm only kidding. You know, honestly, I'm more of a right of center person myself. So I'm not extreme right, but that's part of the reason why I look to right to repair and a lot of these other type of issues that come up.
And believe me, right to repair is more of a left wing issue than a right wing issue.
It is.
Generally, you don't want a right to repair if you're a conservative because you believe the company should be able to maintain that right to do so. Most companies believed you should maintain that. Just like, look, I'm a conservative. I am for net neutrality.
Mm-hmm.
I completely am. And I did a show on net neutrality a while back. And trust me, I am not happy what Trump did with that, and essentially neutered it. I'm not a fan of Trump. Well, I'm not a big Trump supporter, but that's definitely one of the bigger reasons why, is because his administration didn't like net neutrality.
Yeah. And, so I mean,
when you're head of the FCC, used to be the high up in Verizon. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, as I said, I'm a right of center person myself. There's with every politician, whether Trump or anybody else, there's going to be things that you like and things that you hate, that you don't like. I think one of the things that I like about what Trump did is he is not exactly like extreme right. He is more of a he leans a little more towards the centrist view, and that's
Trump
what
isn't a right winger. Trump is a liberal, and he always has been. He knew he could get elected by playing the Republican card. He just knows how to talk the talking points and keep it going. I don't think he honestly believes half the stuff he says.
Yeah, and Blair, no way. Sorry.
Hillary's more qualified, in my opinion, but I still wouldn't vote for her.
Yeah, I wouldn't vote for her either. But I'm not
vote for Biden either. He's crazy as fuck.
Biden is somebody.
We'll probably do an election. What I do plan on doing when we get to the debates, we're gonna do a live stream on the debates.
That sounds good.
We did. I don't know. You weren't a part of the show back in the day, but we actually did. We did live streams during the debates, and those were fun. Maybe because we spent the time mocking the candidates on both sides. It was hilarious. Before that was a thing, I was already doing that. It was fun. So, all right. So, final comments on right to repair, George.
You know, the challenge is this: when you look at the cost of consumer electronics, it's only all of those costs are only going to go up, right? Especially with the move of manufacturing from China to other low-cost centers and coming back to the U.S. And so what we need to do is we need to start to learn how to repair our own stuff again. And that involves simply picking up that soldering iron or getting the tools and other pieces there that will allow you to do exactly that. Right. And I think that is a challenge. The problem is that we have become a society that does not do our own repairs.
Well, look,
I know
convenience rules the land. It's easier to go buy a new device, spend a few $100s, than spend the time to fix something.
Exactly right.
And that's just the nature of things. But you know, take the time to learn. It used to be we learned to repair devices because they weren't cheap. I mean, the average computer when we were growing up was the equivalent of $2,000 to $3,000.
Right.
In today's money, by the way. Mm-hmm. This isn't just then. That's in today's money. It was like
$2,000.
Yeah. I mean, back then it was more like $1,000, $2,000, but and with inflation, that was $3,000 to $4,000. We had to learn how to repair these things.
Exactly right. Yep.
But now they just figured rather than create an upfront cost and make it on the front end, they're play the long game and get you in the end with planned obsolescence, but that isn't working out now anyways, because face it, Moore's law doesn't apply anymore. Mm-hmm. It hasn't, which is every year processor speeds would double, I think it used to be. And that hasn't applied in forever. And technology has kind of reached a peak. It's still improving, you know, software wise, but hardware wise, we're kind of, you know, the average desktop and phone is kind of not really had that many advancements. Hey, we have this many cores. Yeah, but how many cores do you use in your device? Not that many. Mm-hmm. So, you know, learn to repair your devices and push your local legislature to make these documents and parts available to the general public.
Yeah.
This is important to keep the market open and to keep it free, to keep the market open. So that way you have the ability to keep your device as long as you want without someone just artificially telling you, no, you can't fix this.
Yeah. And in case you want to learn more about the right to repair, there's a lot of great channels out there. I brought up, this is the third time I'm bringing him up, but Lewis Rossman, He has a channel on YouTube. He also streams here on Twitch. He streams a lot of manuals and a lot of other components about right to repair. From that standpoint, you could see some of the arguments that he, along with others in the industry, are making regarding access to schematics and parts and other information, things that we actually should have access to. If we buy a piece of equipment, right, it is within our right to seek the repair that we want, whether mm-hmm. in warranty or out of warranty. And these advocates are trying to take away from us.
Yeah.
I personally have a workbench full of stuff that I'm repairing. And you're right, Matt. You're right, Matt. Part of it is time. We don't necessarily have time to do all of it. But from that standpoint, you know, with COVID-19 out there, and the fact that most of us are home, we now have the time. We have more time than we not. And we're going to have more time for the foreseeable future, right? There are people that are getting, losing their jobs and all that stuff.
Yeah.
What better time to learn a new skill and educate yourself and do all that stuff.
And you want to see some cool stuff from time to time, check out George on Facebook. He always has some cool videos and stuff he's doing, sharing his little projects and things he does. Mm-hmm. And once I get my studio set up the way I want to, I'm going to be doing some repair projects on my own, live streaming them, and kind mm-hmm. of teaching you as I learn at the same time. There's a lot of different techniques out there for soldering and how to repair things, and I really want to try different ones and figure out what's the easiest ones to learn. What are ones that the average person can learn that isn't that scary or daunting, and trying to make some recommendations on doing it on a budget and not having to spend a stupid amount of money to do very simplistic repairs. So be sure to check out things like iFixit. It's a really mm-hmm. good site. The YouTube channel, as George mentioned, there are plenty of places you can go to learn how to fix your devices. Keep them alive, repurpose them as a router. You can make an enterprise class router out of an old PC and run your whole network off.
Exactly right.
And it runs a million times better than a Netgear that you buy at Costco for $100. And you just had this device sitting in here, you could do the same thing. All you got to do is spend like $20-$30 on an additional network card, throw it in, bam, all of a sudden you got an enterprise class router and your gaming, streaming, everything improves dramatically. Heck, I sold George on going with you. We're going to do a whole thing on small networks in your home. And George mm-hmm. can already talk about how much he loves that Unify stuff I recommended to him.
Oh, yeah. The Unify stuff is phenomenal. In fact, I wouldn't be able to do my streaming if it wasn't for the Unify routers and stuff like that. And then again, also on top of that, repurposing some of the other consumer stuff that I have to work with the Unify router. I mean, it's amazing what equipment you have that you don't realize could work together with the professional grade stuff, and you get a better equipment streaming setup as a result. So
what topics do you want to hear on Quit Your Whining? Hit us up on Facebook, Quit Your Whining Facebook page. That mm-hmm. is the main place where we're going to post everything for the show. So go there for now. Eventually, I'll be re-spinning up the website with articles and things like that. I want to do that again. I miss doing writing. So we're going to be doing that again. George, where can they find you online, or do you want to promote anything?
Nothing right now, but I will be doing a little more streaming on my personal page soon, and I will be doing a few other things with Gamers Uplink, and I think we got a good show here. I'm also going to be looking at some Hangouts moving forward with some professionals out there, talking about everything from business to marketing to politics, so keep a watch out.
Yeah, and of course me, Admiral Joker on Facebook, Matthew Maciejewski on Facebook. Yes, you can't spell my name, but that's fine. Quit Your Whining on Facebook. And, hey, I also help George with Gamers Uplink, so be sure to check that out. I'm sure we'll have more gaming content coming out, especially as the new Xbox and PS4 are going to be – or new Xbox and PlayStation are going to be coming out. God, that did not go over well with Microsoft's presentation. Believe me, we're going to do something on that real soon.
I plan on it. Yep.
All right. So check us out on Facebook, Quit Your Whining, and let us know what you want to know or what you want the next topic to be about. I think the next topic is going to be about we're talking about doing something about keeping growing food in your own home and how not necessarily prepper stuff, but how to come be more self-reliant on your home and being less dependent upon things like grocery stores and things like that. COVID-19 has shown us that these are not sustainable models necessarily in a crisis in a long-term crisis situation. So yep. We'll talk more about that in about 2 weeks. So, all right. Thank you, everyone. And be sure to follow us and Quit Your Whining on Facebook. Have a great day.
Stay safe, everybody. Have a good night.